So, today we have to go ahead with the roles, characteristics, and skills of a counselor, right? So, when you are acting like a guide or a counselor, you have to have certain skills, certain characteristics, and there is a procedure, there is a way to do counseling. Okay, so we know what are the principles, what is the purpose of counseling, and we have already discussed a lot of skills of a counselor. Okay, we have discussed now being non-judgmental, should open-ended questions, should be able to listen with open mind, and all these things, isn't it? Now we are going to talk about the process. It means the stages of counseling. And how to handle a difficult client, problematic client, and also what are the characteristics a counselor should have. Okay, I'm sharing my screen. I ask you to be ready with some papers because I'll be giving you additional information which you have to take down. Right? Can you see my screen? Right. Roles, characteristics, and skills of a counselor. Okay. So, first of all, before going into anything, we'll see what are the characteristics of an effective counselor. To be a counselor, you should have these some or all of these characteristics within you to become an effective counselor. Okay, the first one is self-awareness and understanding. First of all, you should know what you are, what you are up to, who you are, what is your mental state at the moment, and whether you are in a clear mental state. Self-understanding is very, very, very important when you are doing counseling. When you are getting into counseling, self-awareness and self-understanding is very, very, very essential. What is the reason? What is the reason? What is the reason? What is the reason? Everybody have to talk. There should be an interactive thing, otherwise we can't do this. Right? Just listening to me will not help you. Because this is something which is difficult to do it through an online class. Okay? Teaching counseling is really difficult to do in the distance study. Okay? Since we are trying to do something, you have to interact with me. Otherwise, it's difficult. Otherwise, I don't know what is the understanding that you are getting. Okay? So, you all have to talk. And I don't know whether you can hear me also. When I'm sharing my screen, I don't get your messages also. Right? So make sure that you are interacting. Everybody. Right. Why do you think that you should have a self-awareness and self-understanding to be an effective counselor? What is the reason? Anyone?
If we can't understand properly about ourselves, then it's difficult to understand others. Maybe.
Exactly. And also, another reason is, if you are not in a good state of mind, okay, if you're not in a good state of mind, if you are in a moody state of mind, or else if you are in some other crisis, or if you are in any situations which is not appropriate, you shouldn't get into a counseling session. You can go for a counseling, but you should not do counseling for the person, for another person. Okay? Because the reason is that our moods can reflect in our counseling sessions. Okay? Our moods can reflect. So, we know that our opinions or our ideas, our beliefs, our cultural beliefs, or our social beliefs, our political beliefs should not come into a counseling session. That is a skill that you should have, okay? That is some other characteristic that you should have. We know that we are not supposed to apply our own beliefs, we are not supposed to impose our own beliefs, or our own cultural values or anything to the client, because we are going to accept the client as he is. Now, since we are going to deal with kids, you have to be careful more, okay? So self-awareness and self-understanding is a major first thing that you should have when you're to be an effective counselor. And the second is good psychological health. What is good psychological health? Good psychological health. Now we discussed good psychological health means you shouldn't have any psychological issues. To be an effective counselor, you shouldn't be having any psychological issues. Now I have seen lot of people who have psychological issues, who have gone for psychological treatments and who are under treatment for normal issues, depressions and other things, are trying to learn and become counselors. Now, I have seen in one of my classes, there is a student who has bipolar, right? They can learn psychology and counseling to have a self-awareness, to help themselves, but they should not come into counseling sessions because they can't handle their impulses. Then it's difficult, it will be harmful for the other person who is coming for counseling. So good psychological health should be maintained, and also the sensitivity. There are issues what we are talking in counseling. People come for counseling for something that they can't handle or something that they are vulnerable to. So the person who is sitting in front of a counselor is much vulnerable to certain situations. So you have to be sensitive. You have to show a sensitivity towards the feelings or emotions of the client. So that is another characteristic. And open-mindedness. What is open-mindedness? I told you, whatever the value that you carry, right? Whatever the cultural beliefs that you have, whatever the religious beliefs that you have, you should not impose in another person. So you have to be open-minded to accept the person as he is. Give me a second, okay? sorry. Right. So open-mindedness. You should be able to, the counselor should be able to accept the person as he is. So if a person comes and says, I'm a gay. If you show is it? So that's not going to work. Okay? That's not going to work. Because he is already feeling guilty, feeling socially isolated, feeling that he is cornered, he has no one to talk, he is ashamed and everything. So if you also, when he comes to a counselor, and if you also show that you might be believed that it's against the biological and it's against the society and all these things, but for him, it is something very personal. So you have to be able to maintain open-mindedness in that place. So you can't show your emotions or anything in that. So a person who can accept anything as it is called open-minded. So to become a counselor, effective counselor, you should have this characteristic. And the other one is objectivity. What is objectivity? Anyone? What is objectivity? Anyone? Soon.
Kind of goal. Target. Goal.
Goal. Target. Anyone?
Reason.
Huh?
Reason.
Reason. Anything? Anything else? Objectivity in a sense, you should be able to be independent, right? Independent, not subjectivity. It's objectivity. You should be able to concentrate on the person's issue independently. Not, you are not, you shouldn't be bottled up into some subjects. Like this. If a person comes and says, okay, I want to discuss about my sexual issues. Oh, sorry, I don't deal with sexual issues. Please go to someone else. So that means you are limiting your subjects. You should be able to talk about anything. The objectivity, whatever the objects that they want to discuss, you will be able to be independent to discuss with. You understand? So that is objectivity. Right? Without going into subjects and defining yourself or bottling up yourself into something, you should be able to go out and discuss anything with the client in a decent, genuine manner. And competence. What is competence? What is competence? The knowledge, the intellectuality, the knowledge. You should get enough and more experience and qualification in counseling. Proper qualification in counseling. Proper qualification in counseling knowledge. Proper training. Those who have these trainings, qualification, knowledge about counseling can do effective counseling than a person just go and listen, because everybody can do counseling, right? Everybody can do counseling, saying that they are counselors. That's why we see very poor counseling sessions has gone for many clients. they have gone to certain places and come back with a lot of other issues than the issues that they have gone for, right? Because counseling can make a person and break a person too, right? So you have to be very, very, very competent, right? Yeah. If you don't know something, you shouldn't go and show off saying that you know this, you have this qualification, you have that qualification, sorry. Because giving a wrong information or dealing in a wrong way will make the person break into pieces and make the person to lose the confidence towards counseling. Okay? Then it is difficult, because I have come across a lot of people doing counseling like gossiping and counseling in an advisory way. Okay? We know counseling is not an advising process. We are not advising. We just listen and show the direction and help them to take their own decisions. That is counseling. If it is not in our territory, we will send them to a therapist or else to a psychiatrist. We don't deal if we don't have the competency to deal with. Okay? So the competency to become a counselor is necessary, right? Trustworthiness. What that mean? Trustworthiness. What is trustworthiness? What is your understanding of that word, Tania?
Being able to tell anything without fear.
Sorry?
Being able to tell anything without fear to that person.
You should be able to tell that person, or that person should be able to tell you? Counselor has to maintain a trustworthiness. It means you have to build a rapport accordingly for that person to trust you, and after hearing that, also you should keep it concealed. Okay, whatever the thing that you heard from the person should be with you. It shouldn't be discussed in public or in the society, right? So sometimes, now we use cases, right? We tell, okay, this person came like this, but we never reveal who is it, from where he is, what is his profession, and all these things, isn't it? I have used a lot of cases to explain you these things, but did I ever tell you the name of the person? No. Because that is trustworthiness. You keep the trustworthiness. There are some cases we are not even take it as a study material, because that is highly harmful for the person who is involved in it. So there are cases which we never touch. But there are cases very simple. We can use it in the study pads and all these things, so we used to give you. But there are other cases which is very sensitive, which we never reveal. So the trustworthiness is not revealing, but you know what is the information that you got from the client. So that concreteness, that trustworthiness should be maintained to become an effective counselor. Other one is accessibility. Okay, now you learn counseling. You know counseling, you know how to do it and everything. But if a person cannot reach you, whenever he is in trouble or she is in trouble, if he or she cannot reach you, if you are not accessible, you show a gross face or crossed arms and all these things, or else your phone is not answered, cannot get an appointment, you never answer calls, something like that will demotivate the client, and that will not make you an effective counselor. So accessibility should be there in a proper way. Interpersonal attractiveness. What is interpersonal attractiveness? Anyone? Now, I told you we are learning counseling. This is not education psychology, just to read and go. Okay? We are learning counseling, so you should be able to interact with me. Please keep that. We are not doing it in a classroom. This is very difficult to do without a classroom setup. But still we are doing it because we want to cover the subjects. I will be doing this in a classroom also because I have to show you the lighting arrangements, seating arrangements and everything, right? But for the moment, whatever we can do, we'll do it through the form, through this online setup. But please interact because I don't know what is your understanding is. What is interpersonal attractiveness? Where is this Sanghavi?
Positive attitude or evaluation about the person.
Yeah, positive attitude, yes. What else? What is? Amrita, I don't hear you today. Why? Amrita is there? Amrita?
Yes, she says he can't speak because her throat is upset.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah.
So, okay. So, interpersonal attractiveness in the sense there should be attractiveness between the client and the counselor. The counselor should be able to attract the client. Then only he will talk more. He or she will talk more because he should believe you. He should trust you. There should be attraction for him to sit for 1 hour in front of you and talk. Okay? So there should be interpersonal attractiveness. You should be able to, the counselor should be able to attract the person and make the person sit in front of him for a period of time and talk openly. So for that, we have to maintain certain things like better dressing. That's why we normally, we used to dress. We ask all the counselors to wear saris. Ladies saris, gents appropriate formal dressing. No short skirts, no shorts, no deep cuts, no hanky-panky dresses, right? Because the counselor should create a respective look than an attractive look. The respective look will give the person a trustworthiness, believing, beliefs and all those things. Otherwise, the client might concentrate more than his problem towards the dressing and other postures, and also the postures matters. We can't sit as we want. We have to sit in a position. We have to sit in a way. So those things I will be discussing in the skills. This is characteristics. Okay, these are characteristics. Those things we'll do it in a classroom setup. Okay, we can't do. We'll hope and pray that this corona will go off soon and we'll be able to meet in person in a classroom setup to do this in an effective way. Okay? Acceptance and respect. Whatever the person is, whoever he is, wherever they are come from, counselor should be able to accept the person as he is and respect, show a respect towards them. Otherwise, people will not talk to us because they also will try to disrespect us. So acceptance and respect should be there to do an effective counseling session. And honesty. Whatever the answers that you give, you have to be honest with your answers. And you should be honest with your whatever that you tell. So honesty, maintaining a honesty is really important, and tactfulness. Now sometimes I have clients who ask, miss, if you are in this situation, what you will be? What will you do? What you do? So if a client asks you some questions like this, how will you answer? Anyone? Okay, we'll ask from someone specifically. Someone tell me. Okay, I'll unmute. Let me. I have unmuted you, Netmi.
No idea, ma'am.
There is no idea now. Tactfulness. Now, think the word tactfulness and tell me. Now, if a client comes and he is talking about a situation that he is in or she is in and asking you, ma'am, if you are in this situation, what will you do? No idea. Okay, we'll ask Tanushika. Tanushika. Tanushika, what will you answer? Enna solluvinga? Enna solluvinga? What will you say?
I don't know answer, miss.
You don't know the answer. Okay, Tanya.
I will think of me in that situation and I'll tell the decision that I make.
You will?
I'll tell my decisions that I make in that situation.
Okay, you will tell. Okay.
Miss, can you repeat the question, please?
Okay. If a client, now a client came to you, okay, and he was telling you about relationship issue. Right, some issue, and he is asking you, okay, you are, if you are in this situation, ma'am, what will be your what will you do or what will you tell? What will be your answer?
That means the problem was a relationship issue.
Yeah, whatever the issue.
Okay,
what will be your answer?
To give positive answers.
How do you know which is positive? Okay, I'll tell you this. Ma'am, I have seen my wife with another man. I'm so depressed. I have never do anything wrong to her. I asked her, she confessed that she is having a relationship. If you are in a situation like this, if your husband cheats you like this, what will you do, ma'am? Now answer. I have given you a situation. Soon, we don't have much time.
That's an unhealthy relationship. So... Mm-hmm. Bad for that person to stay in the relationship.
That is your view.
Yeah, my view. But I won't
take. After you tell this, if he goes and divorce, if they have 3 or 4 children, who is responsible? Hmm? these things will come. These type of situations will come, right? We never answer for these questions, okay? We say, you came here to talk about you, not about me. I'm not in this situation, okay? So what do you want to do actually? What is your feelings are? So that is tactful. We never tell what we will do because we are not in the situation. If we answer, that answer is born from our own belief. I told you, we are not put our beliefs, our values to some other's life. Right? So that is not appropriate thing to tell, give an answer to put you in that situation. Putting you in them and being empathetic is okay. Being empathetic for the feelings, not for the situations. Being empathetic for the emotions, not for the situations. So you are not going to put yourself in the situation and answer any questions. It's toxic, don't be in the relationship. Who knows whether this man is treating her well? Do we know that? We don't know. Just because a person came to you, that doesn't mean that you have to take the person's side always and give answers like that. Okay? Tanya, now you got it. So that is, you understand why you should, we shouldn't tell this. Because that is being tactful. Okay? That is being tactful. We never answer these type of direct questions. Right? Sometimes people, definitely, mostly people will come and ask you. Right? Definitely people will come and ask you, what will you do? Never ever put you in the situation and give an answer. Yeah, I will do this. Yeah, I'll be upset. It's not about me. It's about you. I'm not in the problem. You are in the problem. You'll be the best person to judge it. Not me. So what you want to do? Tell me that. What your feelings are towards it. Tactfully transfer. Sometimes you may get to answer for their religious beliefs. Right? People come and say, ma'am, this is a belief. This isn't it true? But your religion says, never answer for these questions. Politics, religion, sexual issues, anything, putting you in the situation and answering is no. Okay? Right. So that is being tactful. Answering in a diplomatic, tactful way. That will give. Otherwise, after we give an answer like that, if something goes wrong, we have to take the responsibility. You told me you will take a decision. So I took a decision like that. Now you are responsible. They will come back like this, definitely. So better to be tactful in these type of questions. Confidentiality. What is confidentiality? Again, something very similar to trustworthiness, confidentiality. You keep everything confident. Even though you take notes, you take recordings or anything, the confidentiality should be maintained. And empathetic. Empathy should be on the feelings and emotions of the client, not the situations, not the problems. If you do that, after that, you will start feeling the distress. Because you have you all ever experienced this? That all these teledramas, once you watch it, you can't unwatch it, right? Once you watch it, you feel like, what will happen tomorrow? Have you seen these ladies who keep watching continuously have this anxiousness? And they scold the bad person as they are in that and all these things. All these things because they feel empathetic to the situation. They put themselves in the situation and see, not for the feelings, right? So after that, they can't live a normal life. If they see a similar action in another person, they just apply that to them also. Then you can't be, you can't do counseling in an effective way. You'll be harming the person. So don't do that, right? Everything clear? Is everything clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Everybody's clear, right? Okay, so we are moving into, so keep these things in mind, right? Skills and other things will come later on. So now we are going for the stages of, okay, Robert Kharkov. Robert Kharkov has 7 core conditions for this counseling. He says a counselor should have 7, has to go through 7 core conditions, right? The characteristics, again. One is empathy, respect, genuineness, concreteness, self-disclosure, immediacy, courage. Now he here, other than the whatever we have gone through for all this time, he says self-disclosure. Now don't complicate this self-disclosure with the tactfulness, okay? Self-disclosure is after hearing everything in the last stage, before terminating, you give some self-disclosure about yourself, what you have experienced, this doesn't happen in the early stages of counseling. This happened in a termination, it means last stage of the counseling. Okay, so self-disclosure is you can share some experience which is similar to that. Something positive or some stories or some of your other experience. You can disclose in an unharmful manner. Okay, not just give all your personal details. That is prohibited, okay? So self-disclosure is something you disclose, you share some of your appropriate experience or information about yourself in a positive way, okay? Not like, okay, if somebody comes and cries, I have this issues, I have this problem. I also have the same problem. And then you both cry and console each other. That is not counseling, okay? That is not self-disclosure. You have to. And immediacy, you have to attend to a problem immediately, right? The immediacy means you have to attend to a problem then and there. You should not drag to attend, okay? And courage. Courage is you should show a genuine interest towards a person's issue. Okay, any questions? Is it clear? Is it clear?
Yes, miss.
Okay, cool. Right, we are moving into stages. Counseling stages. When you start doing a counseling, you should go through all these 5 stages of counseling. Okay. So, these are given for to maintain a certain amount of, it's kind of a process. In every process, in every stage, there are a lot of things that you have to do. There are a lot of questions involved in every stage. Okay, so that's why I ask you to be ready with the notebook. While I'm explaining, whatever it's not there in the this thing, and whatever you understand, you just write in the notebook. If you have any questions, ask me. Okay, don't hesitate to interrupt. It's okay to interrupt because we need to learn this because this setup, in this setup we are learning counseling is really, really tricky. Okay, so let's be very clear and make sure that you are clear about all the things that you are learning. Okay, right. Counseling stages are, there are five stages. One is rapport and relationship building. Second is assessment and problem definition or diagnosis. Third is goal setting. Fourth, initiating interventions or plan of action. Five is termination or follow-up, right? So this is the process, this is the stages of a counseling session, right? So first we are going to look into rapport building or relationship building. So rapport building and relationship building is a psychological climate resulting from the interpersonal contact of client and counselor, right? Psychological climate resulting from the interpersonal contact of client and counselor. Now, here we spoke about interpersonal attractiveness, right? The interpersonal attractiveness, that characteristics helps you to build a relationship, a rapport between you and the client, right? Especially when you are dealing with kids, you have to have maintain certain body languages, certain amount of friendliness, right? Smile, and lot of patience, right? So these things will gain you lot of trust from the client, your young client, especially when you deal with children, right? So you are creating a climate of psychological climate, which depends on your interpersonal attractiveness and living and evolving conditions. So here, in the rapport building stage, you are going to living and evolving condition. You are going to see what is the condition is has happened already. And third is relationship includes respect, trust, and relative psychological comfort. So the client will also has to believe that you are respecting him, you are trusting him, and also you are a trustworthy person, you are a genuine, honest person, and you have a belief in your intellectual, it means your competency, right? If you don't maintain proper eye contact, proper body language, proper seating postures, and proper wordings, he will develop something. He will fall out of trust. He will fall out of belief. Okay, and if you show some disrespectful body language, then also people will not. There will be no proper relationship will get built in between you and the counselee, right? Rapport and relationship impacted by counselor's personal and professional qualification. So competency and attractiveness and all these characteristics which we were talking about is, if you start looking at the person from top to toe and you give a look, staring look, then they will feel very, very uncomfortable to deal with you. And also, first you have to tell your name and also your qualification, what you are qualified for, and what are the abilities and how the experience, everything you have to tell if the client is coming for the first time. With kids, it's not necessary, but with adults, it's pretty necessary to gain the respect and trust from the client. Okay, so counselors' personal and professional qualification is one of the relationship impact, and clients' interpersonal history, anxiety state, interrelation skills, and previous ability to share. Right now, in a rapport building, a relationship building, counselors' professional qualification and personal qualification is also a need. In the other side, from the other side, clients' interpersonal history, what he has gone through, whether he can put himself out, whether he can trust, whether he is honest, and what is his anxiety state. Now, one of my clients, he came in the first day. He never ever allowed anyone to be in the room. Only me, no one else. And his anxiety level is such high, right? But after some time later, he's much settled, and he even allowed our trainees to observe his case, right? It depends on the anxiety level of his level of client, okay? Other one, interrelation skills. What is his interrelation skills? Not ours, the client's. How he deals with, whether he trusts, whether he is an honest person, whether he can talk, or if he's a moody person, you have to keep asking questions. Otherwise, he will free flow. Anything. So you have to have. Sometimes he would have gone for a lot of counselors, lot of psychiatrists, and fed up. And just because somebody forced him to come to you, he would have come and sat there. Right? So that also, then his interrelation skill is very low. Right? And previous ability to share. Whatever he has shared already, you have to remember. And some clients are very shrewd. Because they have told the story to a lot of people, and they have created a entirely different story. Where they show that you have nothing to do with this by telling them. So the previous ability also matters in a counseling. So we'll come, what are the problems? These can be problems in rapport building, handling the client. In later slides, you will get to know this. So these are rapport building stage. So in the rapport building stage, you have to ask questions, you have to tell about yourself, you have to do some disclaimers, disclosures, and all these things. And also you have to get the client's basic information, about name, age, where he from, what is his background, and what is the underlying problem, what is his feelings are, and everything. And you have to record whether you can contact him again, if he is giving the number or anything. You can record all these things. And you have to tell them that we are recording, but this will not go out from the room. And you have to tell them about your disclaimers, like you are under oath, you will maintain the confidentiality, and all these things to build rapport. Any questions in this stage? Do you have any questions? Any questions?
No.
Okay. So assessment. Now we are coming into assessment stage. So in after building rapport, after you've built a rapport, now he trusts you, respect you, and everything, and you got the basic information. Now you are going into assessment. Assessment, you have two ways. One is clinical assessment, other one is observational assessment. Okay, clinical assessment involves specific skills, right? Now, clinical assessment, in the sense, observations, inquiry, associating facts, recording information, forming hypothesis. It means clinical hunch. So these are really too much for you because you are not learning complete course of counseling, right? It's hard for you to digest, I know that, but still, fortunately or unfortunately, these are the wordings that you will get when you learn counseling. So if you decide to learn counseling, you will get more things because this is one whole module. Assessment is a one whole module in counseling, right? We are doing it as a part of one class, right? So clinical assessment involves in specific skills. So the counselor should be able to do a proper observation, right? We say reading between lines. Now, how client behaves, what is his eye contact, whether he is maintaining a proper eye contact or else he is just looking here and there or looking down and talking. So we can assess a lot of things by observing the client's behaviors and inquiry. We can inquire. So if the client is answering in a proper order or else if he is talking here and there, so in that also we can come to certain conclusions and associating facts, right? So he says something, but the fact of association is something else because we do ask questions not only from him, from the person who came with him. Sometimes if it is a kid, we can we will ask questions from the parents, from the caretaker, from other teachers and everything. So associating facts, we will collect associating facts. And recording information, we, as a counselor, we will be having a recording sheet where all these, his social activities, what is observation, what are the basic information that you got, what are the other facts that you got from outside, everything has to be in the recording sheet. Or else sometimes some counselors get the permission of the client and they record the counseling session. So some that. And forming hypothesis in the sense you build something from whatever that information that you gain from the client, you build a hypothesis. Okay, this will be the incident, this will be the reason, this will be, this can be the things that he is going through. Maybe he is having this illness, or maybe he has gone going through this phase of in his life, something. So building hypothesis in the sense you are coming to a conclusion, you are building something according to the information that you got from him. And by paraphrasing, you can reconfirm those things. So before paraphrasing, you have certain things that you have to ask. In this stage also, you will ask a lot of questions. First, you listen to them. After he stops, for your clarification, you also ask a lot of questions to get the information done. In the inquiry part, you will ask a lot of questions. There are certain amount of questions which will be very spontaneous because as a trained counselor, you will know what questions to ask where. Okay. So in this stage, we will come to a conclusion what is the actual problem is and if there is any other psychological issues that he is going through, we will come to a conclusion in this stage. Okay. We will give the assessment sheets if it is necessary to assess whether he is under depression or any other assessments. At this stage, if we feel like, okay, he is in a high sensitive issue or something that he is going through, we will refer them to doctor and we'll get them back, right? So there are a lot of things that we will go through to complete this assessment part. This is normally a bigger section of this section, the assessment stage will take more time than other things, right? So assessment and diagnosis. So in assessment, observation, it means take notice of the client's general state of anxiety, I told you, and establish sense of client's cultural context. By observing, you can do this. Not note gestures, movements that donate emotional, physical dysfunctions. For some clients, they don't answer your question directly. They talk very irrelevant topics. They talk here and then they talk about something else, then they talk and they show some delusion, which cannot be really true. in the world. Now, we have certain clients says, I go to Japan every day. Is it possible? No, it's not possible. But they say, then we can come to some certain conclusion that this person might have some delusional issues. Right? Some says, okay, every day I want to build this and the emotion, they'll be highly emotional in some stage. Some people say, okay, today is the last day of my life. Lot of things can happen, right? So with all these answers and the gestures, by noticing the gestures and physical dysfunctions, you can come to certain, you can build your hypothesis, okay? Here, how the client framed his or her problem. Now, there also you can come to some conclusions like whether he's a positive person, thinker, whether he's a negative thinker, whether he has any other issues, how we portray, how we take things, whether he takes things lightly or whether he is very sensitive, all these things you can come to, you can build your own hypothesis, right? Note verbal and non-verbal patterns. You have to note down verbal pattern and non-verbal pattern, whether he is talking properly, and non-verbal pattern, how he is sitting, how he is maintaining eye contact, whether he is having any stereotype of actions going through. Everything you have to observe. So all these things will help you to build your own hypothesis. Okay, any questions? Anything unclear? Anything which is unclear here? Anything unclear here? No. Everything clear? I can feel like this is pretty vast subject, big topic which we are discussing. Okay. I know it's not not that easy. If you have any unclear parts, just let me know. Okay. Right. So, conceptualizing problems. Recognize the client's need, understand the need, meet that need, right? So, conceptualizing means what he is really going through. So, in this part, you conceptualize the problem, right? You recognize a client need. What actually he needs, what he end of the session, what he really he wanted to be. You can ask as a direct question also, and also you can go as an implied way, like according to his his verbal and non-verbal communication, you can come to a conclusion. However, you recognize his need, why he came for this counseling session. What is his need? And understand that need. Why it is important for him? You should understand the need and meet the need. You have to work towards meeting the need. Okay? Right. Any questions? Any questions? Okay. After conceptualizing, after finding out the needs of the client, we move into goal settings. This is the third stage of the counseling. Okay, so you build the rapport, you diagnose, you conceptualize the need, and everything is done. Now you have to work on the problem. Work on the need, right? So in here, you have to set up a goal. What actual, now that's why we said, in conceptualization, you find out the need, you understand the need, and you meet the need. To meet the need, you have to have a goal setting. So indicates how well counseling is working. If you come to this setup, this stage, it means this indicates the counseling is really working well, right? If the counseling is really working well, you will reach this setup and indicates when counseling should be concluded. Now you know how long this session is going to be, whether you are going to have another two or three sessions, how many sessions this problem is going to have. You can analyze at this moment, at this point, and prevent dependent relationships. Now you are not going to make the client as a dependent of you. You are going to set up the time. Okay, you say, okay, I understand. This is what you need. Okay, this is what you, here you use all your skills, counseling techniques, everything will be used. We are not talking about that here. Okay, I have never spoke about what are the techniques that you have to use. There are concepts that you can use of everything, which will come when you are really learning a counseling session, right? Here you are going in a short form. So after identifying the problem, after identifying what he needs, where should he want it to be, you know how long it's going to take, then you will inform the client, okay, this is the time period it's going to be. So after that, I will be terminating. After that, you will take your own decisions. You are independent. So that means you preventing from him being dependent on you, having a relationship, dependent relationship between you and your client. Determines the selection of intervention, right? How you are going to intervene. In this stage, you will determine how you are going to intervene with the client's problem. What are the therapy, whether you are going for a therapy, whether you are going to send him to the doctor and getting him back, or whether you are going to listen to him, whether you are going to get his support system, right? Everything is going to set up in this goal setting stage, right? So in this goal setting stage, counselor is greater objectivity, okay, and he is training on normal and abnormal behaviors of the client, and he process a experience here. In client's point, client's side, experience with the problem, right? Now we are objective because we know where the client has to go. We are working on that objectivity. Who is expert in the issue? The client has the experience about the problem. So you have to take that expertise, right? And history of the problem. He knows well about the history of the problem, not you. You know what he said, but he knows well about the history. And he has a potential insights. Now more than you have an insight towards him, he has an insight about his own problem and awareness of personal investment in charge, in change, right? He knows. Now, if you say, okay, we are going to have 6 sessions more, he has to be prepared for that. The time that he is going to invest on this, the money that he is going to invest on this, everything has to bond from the client also. So while planning, he knows what his ability about his investments, right? You have the experience in the process. As a counselor, you have the experience in the process. This is what's going to happen next. This is what's going to happen next, everything. But he should have the awareness of his personal investment in change, right? Any questions in this? Nobody can complain later. Right. So we are moving into the next session. After goal setting, we have set up the goal. What are we going to do? What is the progress? What is the process and everything? And the client is also okay with the investment, the time and the money that he is going to put in with. So goal setting part is done. Then we go into interventions. Now we come for this objectivity. Here the counselor uses objectivity. Initiate and facilitate client's change. Right? So when he is going through the therapeutic part or any changes that he is going to, he has to adapt to the change. So as a client, as a counselor, you are going to help him to adapt to those changes. You are going to monitor him throughout the intervention part about his changes. After assessment and goal settings, answer the questions, how shall we accomplish this goal? Now you will ask the question, how shall we accomplish this goal? Right? Assessments and goal settings are done now. Now you will ask him, how are we going to do this? And get his support and his attention and also his concern to complete the set of goals. Okay? Must be related to the problem. The intervention part must be related to the problem. You can't deviate and accommodate all his other needs and all fulfill all your the same. You can't have hidden agendas in this. Okay? Must be related to the problem. Whatever the problem that you are dealing with, you assessed and you are dealing with, it should address on this. You should work on this. You can't deviate from the problem. If another problem occurs, again you have to go to the assessment part and again set up a separate goal for that problem and intervene with that problem in a separate way. Not with this. You are not going to accommodate any other problems into current problem. Selecting an intervention may become an adaptive process. Right? You have to select a proper intervention process. Whether it can be a psychotherapy, it can be a psychiatric treatment, it can be a combination of both, it can be a behavioral issue, so it can be just, it can be a short-term thing, anything, but whatever the intervention, what is the intervention that you are going to choose is very important. Okay? Got it? So we build the rapport, we diagnose the problem, and we set up the goal, and intervention part is also now done. Right? What are the skills that include in the initiation? Skills to initiate include. What are the skills to initiate? Competence with the intervention. So, if I know this client needs a traumatic intervention, if I'm not competent enough to do that, right, I should not do it. I should recommend the person to a proper competent person. I should not do it if I'm not competent with. Right, especially in medications, if you are definitely a counselor is not a competent person to do that. So anyway, you have to send him to the clinician, right, and get him back. So competence with the intervention is the skill that you should have, and knowledge of appropriate uses, how you use. You should be able to have. You should have proper training on the intervention that you are taking. Knowledge of typical client response. If the client is responding in a negative way, you should be able to understand that he is not responding properly. So knowledge of typical client responses and observation skills to note client's responses. You have to note the client's responses, so you have to observe very, very neatly. So observation skill has to be there in the client, counselor, right? Especially when you are dealing with kids, you have to be very, very careful, because kids will say, it's okay to do it, but you have to observe them whether it's really okay to do certain things. Go on with certain interventions, right? Any questions? Is it clear? Is it clear? I'm moving on. Right. So the termination. When it comes to termination, termination in the sense the final part. The intervention is done properly, right? So there is no clear-cut ending. Okay, you're done, you're cleared. From tomorrow onwards, you don't have to come. There is nothing like, okay, nothing like that. People will come slowly. They will develop slowly. So there is no clear-cut ending, but no need to continue beyond usefulness. So once he realizes he is okay with the issues, if he is done with the interventions and everything properly, if he is getting along with the issue, there is no need of go beyond that. You can stop from there. Okay? Awareness by the counselor and the client that the work is accomplished. So once he feels the relief, then also you can terminate the session. May take the same number of sessions as rapport building. May take the same number of sessions as rapport building. So even after some rapport building, after the intervention also, you can have some rapport building. You can say, okay, you can come back to me whenever you want. You can talk to me and everything. And you can terminate for the moment and send him off. Right? So there are three types of terminations. Here we are only discussing three types of termination. One is suggested termination with client's agreement. Okay. Now you are feeling okay. This is all I can do. Here you are feeling okay. And with client's agreement, you terminate. That is suggested termination. Okay. Other one is imposed termination. Imposed termination is a continuous against client's best interest. Right? If the client is not interested, you have to impose a termination in between. Even if client is not cured or anything, you have to terminate. Client is deteriorating, not progressing. If there is a stagnation or no progress in the intervention, it means the intervention or the goal setting is not done properly, or client is not showing proper interest, then you have to terminate the session and go again to the assessment and come back the whole setup again to find out why it is not progressing, why he is stagnated. Okay, so there also you impose a termination forcefully and go back, right? And incompatibility with the therapist. So now normally we have certain issues with some doctors. Everybody is MBBS, right? But we have certain beliefs. If we go to this doctor, we'll be okay. But this doctor will not be okay for some others. So there can be incompatibility with the therapist also. The way the therapist is doing is not okay with the client. So if you find that there is incompatibility, you can stop there and continue with someone else. So that is imposed termination. Client using therapy in place of life. Sometimes clients, they live in the therapy. It means they are becoming dependent. So you have to impose a termination there. If you find out that is happening, you have to terminate it. Now, if you are dealing with a client, if the child started to deal, becoming dependent on you, if he started crying when he is not, can't meet you or anything, then you have to get the indication that he is becoming dependent and you have to terminate the session and hand it over to someone. Because dependency is not a proper counseling way, okay? So client using therapy in a place of life, you have to impose termination there. And third one is situational termination. It means sometimes clients won't show up. Client won't show up. They just stop coming. So you can't call them and ask them to come back. And employment or insurance changes. Sometimes you, now we'll say I'm working for a, going to a company as a counselor for the employees. The employee comes to me, goes, and after sometimes if he's not working in the company, I can't expect him to come there, right? So change of employment, or sometimes just because he's using some other insurance is paying for his treatments. And if he goes with another insurance and he has to, he's compelled to change the therapist, and also the termination comes. So that calls situational termination. And early termination, client just don't return. After first session, if he don't return, it's early termination. After rapport building, some people are there. After build the rapport and after talking for some time, they feel, okay, it's enough, or else they feel it's no use and they don't return, right? Sometimes, now in the situational termination, client moves means client moves from the problem. Here, clients don't come back. We don't know the reason, right? So that is early termination. Any questions? So we have come to the last slide. Any questions? I'm going to ask questions now, if you don't have any. Mulangita. You understand everything? So going through the stages of counseling is the role of a counselor. Taking the client through the stages is the role of a counselor. Characteristics are different, but what are the characteristics the counselor has to carry? Okay. Skills. What are the skills? What are the skills that you have to use? Any questions?
Sandari?
Yes.
Everything is clear?
Yeah.
And the yeah, nalla le.
I just want to study again. And if I have any questions, I ask.
Tanushika, Tanya, Netmi, Amrita, is everyone okay? Tanya?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you think that you got what we learned today? It's pretty a large subject, I know. Right? It's not that easy to grab everything on the same day. That also I know. Right? Give a shot. Read it again. Read several times. Right? This is something that we should have done in a classroom setup. Okay, so it will be more informative. Okay, if you are not okay with the subject, if you want, you just let me know. We can do it again in a different format. If you think the wordings and everything is really hard for you to understand, tell me that also. Okay, before telling all these things, just go through. Okay. While taking these clients, these stages, you will find a lot of problems, right? What are the problems that counselor can encounter? We'll see some few, okay? Problems in counseling. I'll give you a small note of this also later. Clients may show resistance to counseling. Okay? Resistance to counseling. Sometimes it's born from the counselor or by the school, okay, or by the client. So resistance to counseling is a one problem that you face in a counseling session. Counseling with different cultural background. They have own values and expectations, right? Then also, you feel a problem, you get a problem in counseling. Now, if I tell you, I don't know whether I have told you the story. There was a client, he came, he wanted to discuss some personal things. Halfway through, he stopped and demanded me for a male counselor. He says, according to his religious views, according to his values, he is not comfortable to talk that part with a woman. Right? So I have to terminate from there because his religious beliefs doesn't allow him to talk further with me. Where I have heard, so we can't do, two counselors can't do one counseling session. It's difficult. It's not ethical also, right? And he want me to go out. So that is two different things, right? So counselor, counselee's cultural background and values also become a problem in counseling session. Counseling individuals with strong emotions such as anxiety, anger, depression, intensity, etc., which will hinder counseling process. So sometimes some clients shows lot of anger or depression. They don't talk. They don't come out with this thing. They don't feel like talking. They don't feel like talking. So those emotions, strong emotions, anxiety will become problem because they don't talk, they don't pour out themselves, they don't express the feelings properly, they will be more ignorant. You have to be very, very careful while dealing with them. They can be dangerous also, harmful, right? So by that time, you have to. That is also a problem in counseling. That they will be very difficult clients, right? So to deal with them, you have to be more competent in your subject. You can't panic. So for these things, come up with, from these problems, you have to have certain skills and use certain techniques, okay? And counselors burn out. The counselor, when you do counseling, counselor might have some burnouts. They might feel restless, boredom, irritable, lethargic, fatigue. They might develop some negative feelings. Counselor himself. So that is also create problems in counseling session. And lack of awareness of value of counseling by public. Now, some clients come and, okay, just talking to some stranger, will it help? They don't have enough knowledge about counseling. That also be a problem in counseling session. An inadequate administrative setup. When you don't have proper class, proper room setup, proper lighting, where you get a room where everybody walk, or not soundproof, everybody can hear. There are a lot of people around, will not give you a proper counseling setup. So then that will be a issue in counseling. And lack of physical facilities. Lack of physical facilities. Non-availability of time, tools, the training facilities for counselors will also be a problem. Now, if I am prepared to do certain psychotreatment, psychotherapy, if I don't have enough tools, then issues. Especially with dealing with kids. If you don't have toys, colors, drawing books, something, it's very hard to deal with them. Because you can't make a child to sit and talk for a long period without at least some toys. They will feel very scared in a formal setup. So these can be a problem in counseling. Okay. Any other problems that you can think of in counseling? Anything that you can think of? Okay. If you think of anything, put it in the piece of paper and have it. I'll send you this note also along with the slide. So you will have it. If you have any problems, you can feel free to call me or text me. I will answer, because these days I'm on calls for this COVID-19 issue. So we are on a call counseling setup. Most of the time I'll be on calls. So better text me and call. That's better. And okay, I'll be sending you a case. Along with this note, I'll be sending you a case. There are questions under the case. You have to write your own answers and send it to me. Send it to Sangavi. Sangavi can send it to me. Okay. Whatever the answer, just put it and mail it to Sangavi. Okay. Any questions? Any questions? No? Okay, I have given you two homeworks. One is to write down any problem that you can think of in a counseling session, which can occur. And the case, analysis of the case, I will send you with the questions. And the normal thing, you have to write your summary of today's lesson. Okay? Are we good to wind up? 10 more minutes. Sangavi? Shall we wind up if there is no questions?
Sorry, miss?
If there is no questions, if everybody is okay, can we wind up?
Okay, miss.
So the balance, the skills and techniques we'll be doing in the next class.
Okay.
After checking all the answers. Okay.
Okay.
After checking all the answers and discussing the answers, we will go to the next topic. Okay.
Okay, miss.
Fine. No questions? Everybody's okay? Right. Stay safe, everyone. All the very best. And do the homeworks properly. You have enough and more time. So do the homeworks properly. I'll see you on next class.
Okay, yes. Bye.
Thank you, Ms. Gordon.
Okay. Thank you. God bless you. Bye.